Like, hey, you make, if you had to pick a star, no matter what technique you're talking about, it's like the worst star to look for a
Right.
planet around.
There's a lot happening at a lot of wavelengths.
Have you ever wondered what it's like to discover a brand new world? In the last 3 decades, we've found over 5,000 planets outside our solar system, called exoplanets. I'm Dr. Jessie Christensen, the lead scientist at the NASA Exoplanet Archive. This is Explore Exoplanets, The Discoverers, a series where I interview the brilliant minds behind the discovery of brand new planets.
Hi, everybody. I'm Dr. Jessie Christensen. Welcome to another episode of Explore Exoplanets, The Discoverers, where we interview people who have discovered some of the 5,000 exoplanets that we know so far. Today, I'm really excited and happy to have an old friend and colleague from IPAC who is now an associate professor at George Mason University, Peter Plavchan. Welcome to the show, Peter.
Thank you for having me, Jesse. It's great to be here.
Yeah, so describe where you are physically right now.
So I'm on the Fairfax campus at George Mason University. We're just outside DC, in the Washington DC suburbs.
So is it muggy right now? It's late summer
Oh
in
yeah,
DC.
we've had a really, really humid summer. Definitely, although I heard you had some weather come through your way too in Southern California.
Oh yeah, we had a hurricane last weekend. That was a whole
Yeah.
thing. Okay, so you're in Fairfax. Where are you
Yep.
now in your career stages?
So mid-career, I was actually just thinking about this the other day because I turned 45. So it means I'm 20 years away from being officially eligible to retire. Not that I'm going to be able to retire at 65, but and I also realized I'm 17 years since I completed my PhD. So I must be mid-career at this point in my time.
Yeah, at
So I'm
some
going
point
to
you have this realization and you're like, oh yeah, definitely mid-career now.
Yeah, it's nuts. I mean, for a long time, I was in denial about being mid-career.
Right.
So I'm tenured. I've been tenured since 2020, and yeah, now I'm slowly accepting the fact that that I've moved on. I'm no longer early career. Yeah.
And you didn't go straight from grad school into a faculty job, right? You came through IPAC. So do you want to tell us a little bit about your path to get to George
Oh
Mason?
yeah. So I definitely had a, I guess what you might call a non-traditional path, because it was a full 8 years from when I got my PhD until when I got my first assistant professorship position. And in those intervening 8 years, I was at Caltech, at IPAC, at the Infrared Processing Analysis Center there in Pasadena, California, 2 years as a postdoc, and then 6 years as an assistant staff scientist.
So during all of that time, grad school, postdoc, IPAC, did you ever think that you would discover your own planet?
Oh, well, I mean, certainly by the time I was in graduate school, I was hoping I'd find some planets. But I definitely say before I got to graduate school, that probably would have been not something I was necessarily thinking was in my future. So, I mean, when I started graduate school, which I don't want to say how long ago that was, but it's too long ago now, you know, it was the stuff of, it barely transitioned from science fiction to science fact, right? So when I started grad school.
Is that one of the reasons you got into astronomy, because of this transition in the field of exoplanets?
I think astronomy has definitely been a passion almost my entire life. I was a bit weird as a high school student. I worked as a telemarketer in high school, selling free consultations for vinyl siding and thermal windows. And
Oh, okay.
I used the money I collected from that job to buy my first telescope in high school.
Amazing.
And I actually have a repressed memory about my career choices, because I did want to be an astronomer when I was really young. I mean, going even back before high school. And my parents actively discouraged me from it. They had me have a conversation with the local planetarium director where I grew up. And he told me this story, like, you have to go to one of the best colleges. And even once you finish college, you're still not going to get a job as a professional astronomer. You have to then go to graduate school. And even then it's hard to get a real job. And that memory I totally repressed. In fact, I had this moment when I was a professional scientist, maybe about 10 years ago, where it came back to me. This memory just resurfaced. I was like, oh my gosh.
I love this idea that your parents tried to like scare you straight, right? Like you were like, I want to do astronomy. And they were like, no, you got to talk him out of this.
Exactly. When I started college, astronomy was like a word I was not willing to utter because I decided to start with a double major in CS and physics. I ended up only graduating with the physics part, but still that astronomy passion stayed with me. And I did all my research in astronomy.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so you loved astronomy from when you were little, but it was a bit of a circuitous path to get back to it. So grad school, postdoc, IPAC, 8 years before you were an associate professor. Tell us how and when you found your first planet.
I actually was a late bloomer as an exoplanet scientist. Once I finished my PhD, I had a kind of a different philosophy to approaching science at the time. I knew everybody was trying to search for planets with the radial velocity technique at visible wavelengths, and everybody was trying to get on the Kepler bandwagon, and I wasn't part of the Kepler science team either. And so I knew there was a lot of scientists going after this, and I just said, well, maybe I'll try doing something a little different. And so I went in two different directions. One direction is I started looking at young stellar object variability, so not exoplanets per se. And then I also started working on near-infrared radial velocities, which is at the time a really, really hard problem. So we didn't find anything for a large number of years. We thought we had some candidates. So in terms of finding my first planet, I think technically the one I personally found, it might actually be AU-MIC, because we had a lot of false starts with near infrared radial velocities, and I tended to write more kind of demographics or ensemble papers when Kepler was flying. I was kind of a late bloomer, not that I for want of trying.
Right. So let the record show that there is one planet in the NASA Exoplanet Archive discovered by Peter Plavchan. It is AU-MIC B.
Yep.
So tell us about the discovery of AU-MIC B. Like, how did it feel? What were you doing when you looked at the data?
So, I mean, keep in mind, the AU-MIC discovery was the first day the test public data came out.
Wow.
And I think that was December 6th, 2018. But it was certainly December 2018. I can't remember the exact date anymore. And believe it or not, AU-MIC, it was the very first test light curve that I looked at.
Wow, talk about lucky.
Yes, this is why
folks at home, there are literally millions of test light curves at this point. So Peter looks at one and it's got a planet.
I looked at one and just like, wow, I definitely got really, really lucky. I mean take Betapic, for example. Betapic B, the directly imaged planet, the disk is edge on, it has a high probability of transiting, but it doesn't.
Right.
It could have gone the same way with AU-MIC. We could have set a slight tilt of a degree or two, and then we wouldn't have seen anything.
Right. So why were you interested in AU-MIC? Tell us about AU-MIC.
So over the years of working in near-infrared radial velocities, we collected a lot of data on AU-MIC because it's very bright in the near-infrared. So it's very easy to get signal noise. It's a very young star, and it's a very active star. And I'd been staring for years at the velocities we collected as a function of time. And things didn't quite add up as to what was going on in that system from the velocities themselves. In particular, because the star is very young, it's active, it has flares going off all the time, like almost literally all the time, and it rotates pretty fast once every 4.865 days. And it has these two large spot groups on its surface, which it's a canonical example of a class of objects known as BY Draconis variables, named after the star BY Draconis, which they just kind of have large amplitude photometric variability. Like AU-MIC, if you had to pick a star, no matter what technique you're talking about, it's like the worst star to look for a planet around.
Right. There's a lot happening at a lot of wavelengths.
And it confused the near-infrared radial velocities. It confused the test team's search pipeline. And because of all these flares, because of the spots rotating into and out of view. And so again, I got lucky in some sense that it was that active. And going back to that day, that morning, when the data went public, I actually used, and I'll give a shout out to MAST here, no But they had a...
That's okay. We're friends with MAST. It's all good.
Yeah, they had a Jupyter notebook, and I think it was Scott Fleming and I used it to plot the light curve, and my jaw hit the floor, right? So I was just looking at the light curve by eye. I didn't do any special searching tools. I didn't, you know, I've got years of experience, but it just, all I had to do was run a few Python commands, and you could see it by eye. It looked a little funky, like there was a gap during the transit. Mm-hmm. And initially I just saw the one transit by eye, and like a day later we saw that there was a second one. And then like within a week we saw that there was a third one. And the specific feeling that I had over those first 48 hours, it's like, I'm the only person on the planet that knows about this.
Uh-huh.
And then I started going to Twitter. And I saw some colleagues who shan't be named, that were also looking at test light curves. And one of them had shown a plot kind of the full AUMIC light curve with its beautiful spot modulation pattern. I was like, oh no, they're going to find it too. So I actually tweeted about it, if not the first day or the day after, just like to some extent to kind of claim territory, as it were, but at the same time
plant your also, flag in the data. I see the planet,
I see it, but also to kind of share just the sheer joy and excitement.
Yeah,
like, holy crap, like, because AUMIC is such, I mean, outside to the general public, it's not a star that anyone cares about. You can't see it with the unaided eye. You can see it with the southern hemisphere with your eye with a small telescope, but to astronomers, it's semi-famous, particularly stellar astronomers. And it's been a famous star since the late 80s when it was discovered to have debris from an infrared excess indicating there was active planet formation going on there.
Right. It's such a special story that, like, you were so personally connected to this star. You'd studied it, you'd gotten so many different data sets on it, and then bam, there it is. You look at it and you see the planet that you've been waiting for years.
It wasn't on purpose, but I guess luck does favor the prepared.
Yeah, absolutely. And you had good reasons to look at it, and it was the right data set at the right time, and there it was. Very exciting.
Yeah, so it was really exciting, and it was definitely a great way to start off with the NASA test mission.
Okay. So we've established that your favorite real planet is AUMIC B. What's your favorite fictional planet from science fiction?
So I'm going to have to go with Tranter.
Okay.
From the Foundation series.
Yes. All right. We'll talk about that more next episode. So for everybody, please follow us on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter to find out more about Peter's favorite fictional planet, Trantor, and its real-world counterpart. Thanks, everyone.